Bibles, turn with me to the book of Romans. Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1, and we're going to begin our reading in the 16th and the 17th verse. Romans chapter 1, verse 16 and verse 17. And the word reads, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation, to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith." This morning I want to talk about lessons in righteousness. Lessons in righteousness. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the power of your word. We thank you, Lord, that you watch over your word to make it good, to perform it, oh God. We thank you, Lord, that you have exalted your word even above your name, so we honor your word, oh Lord. We ask, Lord, that you will speak even through these feeble lips, that your word will come forth powerful and mighty, that it will teach us the things that you would have us to do and to be according to what you've already done. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. You may be seated in the presence of the living God. Paul writes a letter to the church in Rome, a place where philosophy and government and all manner of things were taking place. He being a Roman citizen, not only a Roman citizen, but a learned Pharisee, he understood the climate in which he was writing. A world was filled with, again, philosophies and mysticism and world religions and so forth. And he comes, he writes this letter, and he reminds them, or he makes a statement, "I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. In spite of all the winds and all the doctrines are floating around, this is what I'm standing on, the gospel of Jesus Christ." He understood that this gospel of Christ is above human understanding, for it is supernatural. Amen. It is the only thing that men could be saved by. And so he says, "I got to let you know, I'm coming from this area. I'm coming with the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes, to the Greeks, to the Jews, and also to the Greeks." He said, in this gospel is the righteousness of God revealed. In the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to ever increasing faith, faith to faith, as it is written, those whom God has justified shall live by faith. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? If you've been justified, your life, your command is to live by faith. You came in by faith. You continue to grow by faith. Amen. And so this morning, I just want to talk about lessons in righteousness, because the Bible is, especially this book of Romans, is filled with lessons in righteousness. I want to jump over to chapter 3, because Paul says this. He says, in this gospel, for therein is the righteousness of God revealed. So lesson number one is we have to realize that it is his righteousness, not ours. Sometimes we are ignorant of the righteousness of God, as the Jews were, and we go about to establish our own righteousness, thinking that if I do enough good things, I will be considered righteous. Amen? Righteousness has nothing to do with what you're doing. Okay? I want you to get that in your spirit. You can do a lot of good things. Not saying don't do good things, but you don't do them to become righteous. Amen? Righteous is right standing in God. You know a lot of good folks come growing up. They were good people, and I love them, but they never accepted the gospel of Christ, so they could not be considered righteous. Y'all not hear what I'm saying? See, it's a lot of time we measure a person being righteous based on what we see them doing. Amen. So the first lesson is we got to realize that righteousness is not ours, it's God's. Amen. Romans chapter 3, verse 20 says this. Excuse me. Now my pages want to stick together. All right, here we go. Romans chapter 3, verse 20 says, it says, therefore, by the deeds of the law, there is no flesh be justified in his sight. For by the law is the knowledge of sin. In other words, no one can be righteous with God by keeping the law, because the law only shows how sinful we really are. Are you hearing what I'm saying? So it's not about what you're doing or not doing. No one can be perceived or be considered righteous with God by keeping a law. Amen? Because the law only shows how sinful we are. If you're driving down the street and you see a sign that says 65 miles an hour, just because you're doing 64 miles an hour doesn't mean you're righteous. It just means you're keeping the law. Amen. For those of you who do 70 at 65, just shows how unrighteous you are, because you always break the law. Amen. So just because you're keeping it don't make you righteous, and just because you break it, it just shows you you're susceptible to breaking it. Y'all not hearing what I'm saying? But the gospel reveals that the righteousness which is of God, watch this, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, is placed on all those that put their faith in Christ. So in other words, the only way we can be considered righteous is that God has to put it on you. And he only puts it on those who put their faith in Christ Jesus. Amen? The only way I will have good standing with Christ is when God sees my faith in his Son. Amen? And it's from that point I have received. See, watch this. In Romans 10, God says this, Paul says this, he said, my heart desire and prayer to God for Israel, my people. My heart desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. I bear them record. They have a zeal, they have a devotion to God, but it's not according to knowledge. For they're being what? Ignorant of the righteousness of God, have gone about to establish their own righteousness. Amen? You see, that's what we do when we think that what we do can be added as righteous or counted as righteous. We try to do our own way. Amen. But they rejected God's way to pursue their own way of righteousness. So Paul is praying that they get saved. And dare I say, we still have that spirit in the church today. Sometimes we think because I've been going to church all my little life, or I'm a member of this church, or I'm an officer, or I hold this position in the church, that these things have made me righteous. No. The things I do is because I'm already righteous. The things I do is because I'm saved. Not to be saved or not to be declared righteous. There's only thing that can declare me righteous is my faith in the Son of God. Just lessons in righteousness. Are you hearing what I'm saying? So in 20, he says therefore by deeds of the law, there should no flesh be justified in his sight. For by the law is the knowledge of sin. But now the righteousness of God, apart from the law, is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets. Watch verse 22. 22 says, even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all them that do what? That believe. For there's no difference Amen. To the Jew as well as the Greek. He says, now there's no difference. It's upon all who put their faith in Jesus Christ. Amen. So it's by the faith, it is by faith of Jesus Christ unto all and upon all them that believe, for there is no difference. Verse 20, here's another lesson. The Bible says, watch this, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Some translations say, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Let me say what it does not say. It does not say, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There's a difference. If it said fallen short, because we a lot of times we quote that, misquote it. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. How many heard it like that before? What that means is past tense. But if you take the fall in and put, as the scriptures say, fall short or come short, that's present tense. Amen? For every day, the opportunity for me to come short of the standard of the glory of God is present. Amen? For all. But just like the righteousness is upon all that put their faith in God. Amen? He continues to keep me in righteousness. Let me put it this way. I was born in sin. Amen? So were you. Shaped in iniquity. Amen? But when I put my faith in Christ, here's the lesson. I became born again. Born in sin, shaping in iniquity. So there's a necessity for me to be born again. I was born in sin, but when I put my faith in Christ, he picks me up and places me in the righteousness of God. Amen. Now watch this. Now that I'm in the righteousness of God, every now and then I still have tendencies, habits that I'd learned when I was born in sin. And when I do those things, God doesn't kick me out of righteousness. Let me prove it to you. How many of you, when you were born in sin, shaping in iniquity, every now and then you prayed? Did that prayer get you kicked out of sin? How many of you did good deeds when you were born in sin? Maybe you helped somebody. Maybe you gave to the poor. Maybe you helped somebody move or did a good act or a good deed. None of those things got you kicked out of the sin state. Are you following what I'm saying? But it wasn't until you put your faith in Christ Jesus that God moved you to the state called righteousness. And now that you're in righteousness, when you do those things that you ought not do, God doesn't kick you out of righteousness, but he does set a path for you. He said, confess it. I'll be just to forgive you and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Because you've been born again. I'm just talking about lessons in righteousness, y'all. For all have sinned and fall short. I don't care who you are. The Bible uses a word, a three-letter word that is so powerful. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of the glorious standard that God has established. Amen? But God, in his grace, his undeserved. Amen? How many of you, sometimes you don't feel like God, you deserve how God has blessed you? I don't. I don't. A lot of times I don't feel like I deserve it, but I thank you. I thank you. You know, some things that happen, you know, I realize I deserved it, but his mercy kicked in.
Hallelujah.
Amen. I deserve some things that happen. Truly, I do. But thank you for your grace. Amen. You follow what I'm saying? The fact that he's placed us in righteousness, the Bible says watch this, 23. It says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace. Being justified freely by his grace. Amen. Through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God has set forth to be the propitiation or the sacrifice. Amen. Through faith in his blood to declare his righteousness for the remission or the removal of sin that are past. Let me deal with that for a moment. Again, we're talking about lessons in righteousness. When we put our faith in the propitiation or the sacrifice, the blood of Christ, the Bible says that it is God that declares us righteous. Amen. Watch this. It is God that declares us righteous. Amen. He declares us in his righteousness. He puts it on us and it's for the removal or the remission of sins past. That's what it says, right? To declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past. Then watch this. It then says, through the forbearance of God. To declare, I say, at this time, at this present time. In other words, the one that declared it in the past continues to declare it in the present. Y'all not hearing what I'm saying? Y'all not hearing what I'm saying? To declare, I say, at this time, his righteousness, that he, God, may be the justifier, may be just and the justifier of those that put their faith or those that believe in Jesus Christ. Amen. See, this is what we have to understand about God. We're so day oriented, we're so time oriented that we forget that God is not subject to time. See, there's nothing I'm going to do next week that will surprise God today. So he already fixed it up and worked it out. So if I do stumble next week, he's already made a way for me to stay in his righteousness. Because his God is just. See, you might think my stumble is permanent. You might judge me for my stumble. But God has already fixed it. So if I stumble, I'm just talking about lessons in righteousness. See, this is why we can't condemn each other. We should be praying for each other and helping each other. Because the same thing that you're helping someone, you might need help with. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying to you? We're talking about lessons in righteousness. When we put our faith in the blood of Christ. This is all he's looking for. See, when he says watch this. He is just and the justifier. Amen. Not me. Not you. Amen. God is the just. Amen. And he's just in justifying those that put their faith in Christ. See, this is why the gospel is called good news. Amen. It's so much good news in here. The good news is that those that he holds, he will in no wise cast out. But the key is, as Jesus told a very religious man who based his religiosity in the works of the law of Moses, who based it in the things that he was doing, he says, you got to get born again. If you don't get born again, you will never comprehend, you'll never perceive what the kingdom of God is all about. You won't enter it, and you won't perceive it exists, except you get born again. So the necessity or the prerequisite of being in the righteousness of God is getting born again. Putting your faith in the works of Calvary's cross. Amen. Refusing to accept God's way is a death sentence of eternal damnation. We need to tell people this. Amen. Because the world is still lying. The world is still saying there are many ways. There is no other way. There is no other way to God but through the Son. If there had been any other way, you think God would allow his Son to die? To die such a horrendous death? If there was any other way, even Jesus said, Lord, if there be another way, let this cup pass from me. But nevertheless, not my will. Thy will be done. His mind was on me as he hung on the cross. His mind was on you. He said, no man can take my life. I have power to lay it down. I have power to pick it up again. Marvel not that I say these things. I'm just telling you what my Father has said. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And because he has given me this undeserved gift of righteousness, this undeserved gift of salvation, this undeserved gift, I thank you, Lord. And I got to share this good news. Thus, Paul says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes in it. Is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, those who've been justified, don't you go from faith to flesh. Go from faith to faith. Go from faith to faith. Let your faith take you higher in wisdom, higher in knowledge, higher in understanding, higher in walk, higher in commitment, higher in love, higher. Go higher in your faith. Grow your faith. Don't let your faith get stagnant. Live by it. Don't die in your flesh. Amen. Lessons in righteousness. Let us pray. God, I thank you for this, your word. I thank you for the time that you've given us. Father God, we ask that your word will manifest itself, that we will have fine practical application as we thank you for such an awesome gift, Lord, a gift that continues to give. A gift that lives eternally, Lord. It's dealt with my past. It's dealing with my present. It will deal with my future, oh God. Thank you that I can rest secure in your arms, Lord. And Lord, let me never take it for granted, Lord. But allow what you've done for me. Allow it to work in me, Lord. That I might be conformed into the image of your dear Son. That we might be conformed, oh God. Use us for your glory, Father God. And then, Lord, help us to be the witnesses of righteousness to this world, Lord. The world needs to see good testimonies, need to see good witnesses unto thee, O God. Father, you said we've been called from the foundation of the world, and that our purpose is to be, and our destiny is to be conformed into the image of Jesus. Have your perfect work in us, O God. David said, create in us a clean heart and renew the right spirit, O God. The transgressors will be converted unto thee. Hear our prayers this morning, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us stand. There might be someone here today who wants to recommit their lives to God, who wants to make Jesus their choice. And I say make him your choice, but truly that's in your heart. That's because he chose you. Amen. You're here today. I want you to just come down and just take a seat on the front after the service, after the benediction. Someone will be praying for you. If you're watching online, there's a number, should be a number on screen where you can call, and someone will pray for you. Amen. Amen. I'm going to ask you to get your communion cups together as we honor Lord and remembering of him. as we promise to do as the first of every month. He says that often as you do this, you do show forth my death and burial and until he returns. We can do it every day. We can do it every Sunday. It is our custom to do it once a month. Amen. I want to read to you what Paul was, what was revealed to the Apostle Paul in Corinthians chapter 1, chapter 11, 1 Corinthians chapter 11. He says to them, for I have received of the Lord that which also I deliver unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body. Then he said, this do in remembrance of me. After the same manner, he took the cup. When he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Then he says, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. This is what we do before we partake of it. There's a time that we should examine ourselves. And we examine ourselves truly when we don't compare ourselves with others. A lot of people's examination is based on what they see others do, but the truth foundation of every true Christian is their personal relationship with Christ. And we have to ask ourselves, Lord, am I pleasing you? Am I doing the things that you've called for me to do? Have I done things that are unpleasing to you? And if I examine myself and I find some areas that I've fallen short in, I repent of it. I say, God, repentance is just finding agreement with God. God, you're right. Not making any excuses, but God, you're right. And then after I examine myself, knowing that he's faithful and just, then I continue on with communion. Don't stop taking it, but examine myself. Amen. Examine yourself. And so as I pray, Lord, Father God, I thank you for this time of regathering. We thank you this time of remembrance. Father God, as we individually, Lord, examine ourselves, Lord, I pray that if anyone in this room, Lord, that they find something, and I'm sure there's much to be found, but that we will follow the steps of your word. You said, if we sin, confess our sins. You'll be faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Lord, I just don't want to be unworthy taking of your bread, of your flesh and drinking of your blood. So purge me, Lord, of anything, and thank you, Lord, for forgiving us, oh Lord. So you said when you took the bread, you broke it, and you said, take, eat, this is my body, which is given unto us. Let us commune together. And after the same manner, you said, you took the cup, after you blessed it, you gave it to the disciples, you said, drink, for this is the blood, this is the new covenant that I have with you. Let us commune together. Amen. If you have drinking of his blood, you have eaten of his flesh. What other way to demonstrate commitment to you than to die and shed his blood and to see his flesh broken for you? Let us respond by remembering our commitment to him, by not forsaking our assembling of ourselves, by finding the work to do because we are righteous. It's not just going through the motion. It's about being the servants that God wants us to be. There's somebody who needs your service. There's somebody you are called to be a blessing to. It's not about you. Life is not just about you and what you can obtain. It's about what you do and what you give. The Church of Macedonia, they gave a lot. But the Apostle Paul said they first gave of themselves. sacrifice of yourself. Those are the ones that God will call great in his kingdom. Amen. Let's lift our hands unto the Lord. And now unto him that's able. He's able to keep us from falling. He's able to present us faultless before his presence with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power. Now, henceforth, and forevermore, the Lord your God, he sure enough loves you. He loves you with a love that is unconditional. He loves you so much that he gives you opportunity after opportunity. He loves you so much that he sent his son to die for you, that you might have eternal life with him. He wants you to live forever with him in his presence. So we thank you, Father, for what you've done and what you're doing. We ask, Lord, that the power of this communion, the healing power, resonates in our bodies, Lord, that we will show forth your praises and glory, for it is you that has called us out of darkness and into your marvelous light. So we praise you this day in Jesus' name. And the saints said, amen. God bless you. God keep you.